The onset of the pandemic rapidly crippled airlines around the world. Virgin Australia was already having financial issues before the shittiest global event in modern aviation history came along and sucker-punched the airline. Travel, even domestically within Australia, was instantly restricted. In April of 2020, Virgin Australia declared insolvency. Many of their creditors, aircraft leasing companies who own many of their planes and who are also taking massive hits around the world from other struggling airlines, saw the writing on the wall. Bain Capital, the company that would ultimately purchase the airline from the creditors, saw a way to renegotiate leases in the wake of all the financial bloodshed upon the leasing industry. Anyway, a call was made to return some aircraft to the U.S., and we were called to get the job done by two different leasing companies. Only problem, it was peak 2020 lockdown COVID times, and there were zero airline options for getting 10 pilots and a mechanic into Brisbane at that point. That's right, 11 of us, to move the first five airplanes in a string across the Pacific simultaneously. Time to get creative.
Can you believe the engines are running?
The cost to get 11 pilots from the USA to Australia business class would have been pretty pricey as it was, so the fact that the only way to do it was to charter a Falcon 7X was in the cards. Through a guy on Twitter, actually, I learned of a brand new 7X coming off of an exchange, and it was stateside, heading back to New Zealand empty anyway. We got a pretty good price on the charter. I then decided to name the mission, something I've never done before because that's totally lame. I named it Ocean's 11. I also made the rash decision to tell my Twitter followers the name of the project, a decision I'd later live to regret. I don't know a pilot, or even a person for that matter, that wouldn't jump on the opportunity to ride as a paying passenger on a $50 million business jet from LA to Brisbane. I was alongside nine of the most experienced ferry pilots I know, guys I've worked with for over a decade. Each and every one of us was like a kid in a candy store in that thing. I remember sitting at my computer assembling the team, and it wasn't very hard to find willing participants. A last-minute spot even opened up a few days before we left because Bob fell lightly ill with COVID. Ava was there, so was Rico, and I also had the pleasure of flying with one of my favorite guys to have around, Captain Rye. Rye is a super experienced captain with a bunch of types all earned at major U.S. airlines. The thing about him is, he's even more adventure-loving than me, and that's saying a lot. He, and not for the first time, often takes advantage of unpaid leave from his employer. During said leave, Rye does stuff like fly UN missions for 6 months in Africa, or fly single-engine seaplanes for a season in Alaska. When he's on leave, he slots in as one of our regular go-tos.
Early bed, early to rise. Or just get up early and get out to work. Alright, time to get back to base.
So right now, guys,
thank you, if I may.
Yes.
Cameraman, follow me to the window. You can't see anything, but we're about to land in Oahu, and it's a real deal.
My name's Ryan. We're going to go across the world and back in about 2.5 days.
Unlike a ferry trip where we fly under CFR Part 91 and aren't limited by regulation related to duty time, the Falcon 7X crew were operating a charter under Part 135, which has rules in place for how long a crew can remain on duty. Due to the amount of time to fly between California and Australia, they required a rest period in Honolulu for the trip, so we all got a chance to unwind on the beach in Waikiki for the afternoon, and a chance to sleep and shower at our normal crew hotel, the Outrigger Waikiki Beach.
We're here in Oahu, in Honolulu, so heavily masked.
If it ain't Falcon, I ain't going.
We're all ruined forever. We can never fly on normal, poor people airplanes again.
In the van, which was really more like a high-end limo-style bus, dropped us off at the curb in front of the hotel, I was immediately taken aback by the shocking emptiness of the street. Waikiki Beach is normally a chaotic hellscape of tourists, locals, street artists, and traffic pretty much 24/7. The Outrigger Hotel, because they offer a really competitive crew rate, is one that I probably visit 10 to 15 times per year, considering that Honolulu is the only tech stop between the South Pacific and the United States mainland. Because of COVID, however, I hadn't had any requirement to come through in several months, and I had no idea what to expect. The place was an absolute ghost town, and none of the shops and restaurants were even open. There were no tourists to be found, and even the beach was merely speckled with a few socially distancing locals respecting the strict rules that the state was enforcing.
Just got to the room here in Waikiki on our overnight on the way out to Australia, so not too bad. Pretty nice day here in Waikiki. Our pilots are gonna need to realize that it's never this good. This is about as good as it gets. This is not the norm.
Some of us wandered about outside and snapped some pics, and we ended up all ordering takeout from Duke's, the Waikiki dinner staple located inside of our hotel. We found a few picnic benches in an outdoor laundry area, which sufficed as a dining room for our motley crew. After a decent night's rest, we were up at O'Dark 30 to get back on the jet and make the 11-hour trek across the Pacific to Brisbane. We got a good amount of sleep on the overnight, but we would have to hit the ground running and depart no more than 2 hours after landing in Brisbane, and then not stop again until landing back in Hawaii. We slept as much as we could on the long ride down. The mid-pandemic arrival protocols were strict and were arranged in advance by my team. Wes, our man in Thailand, had been in constant communication with the handling agents for about a week. Still, we put on uniforms before landing so people's heads didn't explode seeing 11 guys in t-shirts get off the Falcon 7X and then hop into airliners and fly away. We pulled in, hopped off the plane, and hustled over to the bus. Along the way, I passed a fence where a guy with a microphone and a camera crew called me over. Now, I'm not sure why I thought it was a good idea at the time to walk over there and talk to the man. I guess I got caught up in the moment. This was no ordinary deal. A 5-ship Trans-Pacific with a luxury bizjet entry. It was one for the ages.
On board from Honolulu to Brisbane. A Falcon 7X, a $54 million jet owned by a Brisbane winery family, chartered to carry a payload of American pilots.
We've never been on a luxury airplane like this. We're repo guys.
The crew of 10 pilots and an engineer call themselves Ocean's 11. Ocean's 11.
Ocean's 11.
Ocean's 11.